Hi everyone, thanks for joining me for the third to last column in this shelf by shelf series. Yes, I know. Cry. Don't worry, there's still loads more videos yet. I mean, what, we got like this one and 11 more and then two more for the top of the shelf. And it's not like you're strapped for choice with the 35 other videos I've put out before even this one, I think. Or was it? No, 36 even. So there's quite a few. We're now looking at Libelude, and I still don't know if that's the proper pronunciation, I do apologise, but this is going to be a much more lighter fare for games. So let's start with the odd one out in this saga, actually, and we're going to go with Seasons, because the other three are kind of linked, and you'll see why soon. But Seasons, whew, has had some wear and tear. But Seasons is one of the most gorgeous looking games that I have in my collection from a card, effectively a card game. And it has one of the best components I have ever found in a board game ever. Seasons is this really good, it's hard to say, it's an engine builder, but it's a unique card engine builder. You draft these cards at the start of the game, which are magic cards and like familiar cards, and like demon cards, whatever they're called, well, not demons. What were they called? They call them familiars, but basically like elves, you know, magical creatures. Yeah, call them that. But this is, you're basically a wizard participating in this three-year tournament. And each year, you get more cards, you get more options. But the way it works is that this timer down here, this chart, this dial in a sense, you go through the four seasons of the year, and in each season, you get different mana available and non-available, depending. Like, for example, in the winter, you can get air and water pretty easily. It's harder to get fire. It's not impossible to get earth, you know. But you go through, and as well as having access to the different manas, you roll these different dice in order to draft these dice, get mana, get ability to transmute into points, or to gain more cards, you know, various other effects. And when it's your turn, you resolve your die, and you get to play these cards in a very much Magic the Gathering style. Pay the mana, play the card. Nice and straightforward. The abilities are easy enough. They score your points. It's a relatively simple game to grasp. There's even a good port of this on Board Game Arena. But what do I really love about this? Besides the fact that for 2 to 4 players, this scales pretty well, and in a 2-player game, you can get this done in 60 minutes without too much trouble. It's got expansions, but no. Look at this. So, first off, that's what you normally got in the game, okay? You know, these plastic tokens, which look good. Nothing wrong with them. Try this on, Saz. I found on eBay, I think it might be on eBay, I don't know, but somebody, don't ask me who, I can't remember the source, but they were doing these plastic tokens. I think they came onto Facebook groups, actually, and started advertising it, but look at this. Plastic mana tokens that look authentic, feel good in the hand. I love these. And I think I've got a spare set as well. For some reason, I ended up with 2 sets. Maybe I was using them for another game, I'm not sure. But look how else I've pimped this up. One thing I didn't like about the game was that it has this chart for tracking score. And you put a cube on it and you track your score through there. That got irritating. It's the one blemish I have on this game that can get a little bit fiddly. Not when you go on eBay or Amazon or wherever it was and find these babies, though. I've replaced that point track with actual plastic crystals. So, and I've just broken that bag. See what happens when I show you stuff? Now I've got to find another bag. But look at this. Oh, big chunky plastic crystals there. You know, I can use the small ones for a point and the big ones for 5 and the orange ones for 10, you know, for example. So now I've got more than enough ways to track points in a much more nicer way than doing it before. And I need a new bag. Thank you, internet. But here's the big one. I gotta be careful because every time I pick these up, I go a little bit schoolboyish, fanboyish, and yeah. The best dice in any game ever. These, you have like 5 of these, I think. Is it 5? Yeah, 5 for each season, right? And depending on player count, you use so many of them. So it's randomized and they've got different faces. But basically, if I'm in the autumn, I roll the red. Fire, I roll the yellow. You know, spring, I roll the green, etc. And they're just, I'm sorry, I just get a kick out of these dice. They are just so good to roll. I mean, this is the one thing that the port of Seasons will never replace, these dice. chunky, tactile. They are just so satisfying to roll. I cannot wait when it's my turn in the game that I get to roll these. And I need a minute. Okay, stop that. You've been told that. You've been told this by your therapist. Right, okay, so with seasons out of the way, let's move on to these three. Now, they're linked in the sense they use essentially the same card mechanic, but it's a mechanic I love. And in fact, you'll remember I came across a pseudo-sister of these ones called Detective Club in that shelf when I was talking about it before. But let's start with the originator, the first one, at least, that I found. Dixit. Can you beat Dixit for like an all-round introduction level party game? For something that is unique and new to modern gaming that will get new gamers in. This is still fantastic to play. And this is heavy because it's got quite a few cards in here. This has everything from Dixit Odyssey with the much better score track. But yeah, it is crammed with sleeved cards. I mean, I have so many cards for this. It is unreal. I don't even have the boxes for them anymore. I don't even have all the expansions. I think I stopped. I think there's one or two I don't have, but that's just because they simply will not fit. But do I really need more cards? I mean, that's just one bit and stack that big. There's some all skewed around the bottom, and then there's these. Yeah, I'm not exactly short on Dixit cards. I can take a point. I can take a hint. But Dixit just works. It's so simple to play. People get into it with the style of it, you know, like thinking up clues and that. But it uses the mechanic of those picture cards where you have to give a clue about a picture and then everybody thinks about, ooh, which card matches that clue that I've got. Put them down, reveal them, and everyone tries to guess which card it is, as well as try to coax people to guess their own. Simple concept. I find that pictures, I mean, there's a reason there's a saying that a picture is worth 1,000 words. Because it is. You know, code names, for example. I don't have code names in my collection, but if you want to get me to play code names, it's got to be the pictures version. The pictures version gives you so much more leeway to come up with ideas, whereas a word, a single word, is very restrictive. So I much prefer the pictures version. But with this, if this was a similar game but done with words, it wouldn't be anywhere near as fun. But you get some of the most surreal looking artwork possible. I mean, like Tim Burton on crack. It's really like some crazy stuff on here. And it just goes over well. Here's the top tip though. One of the best questions I love to do in this game, you know, when you're given your clue, I like to put down a card and say, this reminds me of X person at the table. You know, this reminds me of Jacob, Veronica. Where did I get that name from? But, you know, reminds me of Luke. And honestly, try that in your group. It works so well. Because, you know, everybody will be paranoid as to what sort of, like, card is going to come out for them. And then the cards get revealed. And with the surreal artwork, it just leads to some great laughs. Even did it on an ex-girlfriend once. And don't worry, that wasn't the reason she's my ex. But it worked quite well to watch the rest of her family basically come up with these cards to describe her. And it's like, okay, I went for the nice card. I don't know what the rest of your family are doing. It works wonders. Evolving from Dixit, though, we have Mysterium. And I still like Mysterium. This is another one of those it's cool to rag on it games. I don't know why, but why is it cool to rag on this game? Because it is a great game. I got to hold it tight because as soon as I turn it up, I'm worried about the insert. But look at that. Lovely, gorgeous game. This huge board that you've got for the ghost to hide behind. It's basically Cluedo with the Dixit mechanic. So with this one, you've got the location, the people, and the weapon. Although the expansion brings in stories, which is much better. And using, again, these picture cards, you are essentially working as a co-op this time. So the ghost can't speak. A bit like Deception Murder in Hong Kong in the other room. And the ghost has to provide clues for everybody. They can see which visions they're happening of their... Everybody's got their own person, location, and weapon to think of. And the ghost gives Dixit-style art cards to the players based on which ones he needs them to get. So I need you to point at that person now. Right, well, this card with a badger riding a unicycle is probably good. And this will tell you what you need to know. So as you watch each player look at you dumbfounded as to what on earth are you trying to tell me here? And it's like, it could be a subtle hint, like, you know, that tiny little piece of clothing with the buttons on. Look, it's the lady with the sewing kit. It could be something as quintessentially obvious as most of this card is green, so is most of the card on that one. And it's like, people may or may not get it, but it encourages discussion among players. The ghost, I'm not blaming the ghost in this game. I like that tension of having to choose these cards and come up with decent clues. I love it. But I also like watching the rest of the table discuss and have fun and come up with stuff. Because I'll be there sort of thinking to myself, you're smart. You're smart. You're smart. Quiet you. As one person butts in trying to think, but no. Have you considered that because this is a Tuesday and this badger is brown, it's like, no, get off. It's like, you know, you're there secretly loving some players and secretly cursing others. I love that tension. It also makes this one of the easiest, most fun games for me to teach because with this one, I just say I'm the ghost. Because most new people to this game don't want that responsibility of being the ghost. So I say I'll be the ghost. And I talk them through the rest of the game. I'm trying to help them. I'm not trying to make things harder for them. And they get to have the discussion part. Honestly, this is still a solid game. I don't get why people are ragging on this one so much. It came out and people were thinking, oh, this is really cool. It's like really new and innovative. And it is pretty innovative. I mean, you know, combining Dixit with a co-op mechanic. You know, it is a pretty innovative game. But for some reason, every time another game comes out with the same mechanic, everybody suddenly now jumps on the Mysterium hate train and goes like, oh, it's boring, I don't particularly like it. And it's like, what happened? What changed? This is still solid, I'm still keeping it, so there. Partially because of this game, though. This is why some people are ragging on Mysterium. Obscurio, and also Deception, Murder, and Hong Kong is another example. But basically, more of these games are coming out with the cool Dixit artwork. This is still co-op, however, this is more of an all versus one version of it. With this one, this is going to be hard to pack away later. But you won't be able to see it very easily on here. But basically, you've got these like circular cards in order with all the Dixit style artwork on it, but you're all trying to get out of this library. It's kind of like you're trying to get out of effectively a Hogwarts library. But one of you is the traitor. You know, one of you is the book or the ghost who is trying to help everybody get out. And so based on this like really cool magnetic book that they have, I wonder if it's still in one piece actually after turning it over. Let's see. Could be better. I need to bag up those tokens, but you have this thing. This really cool, you know, magnetic book where you can put the cards in each bit as you're showing it to the other players. And on top of that, you have these little pieces and the magnetic pointers. There you go. Magnetically supports it. You can put it on this part in order to point at the whole card, or you can point at a specific aspect of said card, and it's better when you've got the whole thing like, there we go. Yeah, so I could just point at that dude right there, you know, as a very specific thing. The problem is, it's not quite that simple. Firstly, there's a traitor. Somebody wants to stay in this library. I always blame it on the bookworm in the group, and I know a couple of friends who are a bit like that. But with this one, the traitor is able to look at the cards that are available, like from, well, like the clues that have been given, and then they get to look at a separate, like, portfolio of picture cards. Oh, I haven't packed this up in the last game, so they get to look at this and pick cards that they think will throw off the other players. So they've got a little bit of extra information. So you've got that hidden aspect that somebody in the group doesn't want you to leave, and you've got to try and suss it out before the end of the game, because if you don't, you'll automatically lose. But on top of that, they make life harder, and this is definitely a harder game. You've got trap cards that give you less time, that force you to make, like, decide between more options, that force some of them to be face down before you like decide on one. And my personal favourites is where you get the trap cards. I'm trying to get them out of here. Where it forces you to put these on the cards that you're showing. So you can have one that's like obscuring all the colours and one that's got all this wispy nonsense on here that distracts the eyes. It's a really cool game. I mean, it's a solid game and I do really like it. It's in the collection. But it doesn't replace Mysterium. You know, this isn't a co-op with a traitor. That is a full co-op. Both have very different mechanics for deciding on like the clues and that. So, and this one is definitely the harder of the two. I mean, if you thought Mysterium was easy, and I could see why in some cases. I mean, it's got easy, medium, and hard. There is no reason to play Mysterium on easy. And, you know, you basically always start on medium and then go to hard when you're a bit of an expert. With this one, though, you start on easy. You start on easy and you stay on easy, at least for a long time. Because to play this on medium difficulty or hard, is hard. I mean, with a traitor even knows half of what they're doing, medium difficulty is very tough. And to be fair, I have lost more games of this than I've won it, because it's hard to get everybody to focus on the cards and see the clues in that, harder than the Mysterium. So honestly, start off, get a lot of players, you want at least 5, if not 6 or more players in this, and start on easy difficulty, trust me on this. But it's a solid game. Which one do I prefer? I would say Mysterium, because of the full co-op nature and the difficulty curve is a bit more forgiving for newer players. This one will beat you up a bit, but it's a solid game in its own right. So yeah, I like the picture card mechanic. I look forward to more stuff from this publisher, you know, if they're going to use that mechanic in other games. Detective Club in the Other Room was an example of another fantastic game that uses it. I just really love that mechanic, because I prefer to look at a collection of pretty pictures or surreal imagery than a bunch of words or a bunch of cubes. You know, one looks nice, the other doesn't. So come on, you can see where I'm coming from here. So yeah, that's it for shelf, what's that now, 37 I think? We're going to move on to Lookout Games, a mix of heavy and light and two-player even. So hope you'll get something out of that one. See you next time. Take care.